Hello. Hi. You awake? Food comas? That was an amazing lunch, wasn't it? It's really a pleasure to be here with you today, and thank you so much to Vipe and to the crew for inviting us and having us come attend today's Rising Tide Summit and talk with you a little bit about our story. Who in here still sucks? Raise hands. Anybody? Yeah, there's a couple of you that still suck. Okay, that's okay. Maybe after this presentation you won't suck as much. So, Lonely Well. Lonely Well is a very young nonprofit. We're also a very tiny nonprofit. There are three of us. We have an amazing board of advisors, including Vipe and others. And we set off in 2016 to really make sure we understood where our place in the ocean health conversation lies. There's so many organizations out there doing incredible work. What can what yet another ocean health organization add to this conversation? And as we looked across all of the ocean health issues, slavery on the high seas, seismic blasting, deep sea dredging, oil spills, the list goes on, right? There's so many issues facing the ocean. We decided to focus on marine litter because we felt like with marine litter, we could start to create a connection between people and the ocean. This big, vast body of water that provides us with our life support system is something that is almost completely unattainable for the vast majority of us. We look at it, but we take it for granted. I live in Seattle. I'm in the Puget Sound. Can I give a heck yeah for Seattle? Who else is in here from Seattle, Puget Sound? There's a couple of you in here. And I look out at the Puget Sound every day, and it's beautiful. It glistens. It's blue. So it's healthy, right? I don't give a single thought to there are microplastics in that water, that our salmon populations are in complete decline year after year after year. Our orcas, their flesh, their bodies are toxic. I don't think about that at all, and I'm in this space. So how can we expect the average everyday human to really think about the ocean and think about its health and think about our connection to it? So we decided marine litter was it because we are connected every single day, every single one of us to plastic, every single one of us to trash. We come into contact with it, we generate it, we walk past it on the sidewalk. So what better way to connect people to the ocean than through this one commonality that we have? But we knew we had to do it a little bit differently. If we were truly going to be an additive organization and really change the conversation around marine litter, we had to think a little bit differently and think outside the box. So that's the story that I'm going to share with you today and why we decided to take a different approach to talking about marine litter and what we think some of the results are. Okay? Okay, so plastic is the time bomb that's exploding in our ocean. I don't really know where to point this thing. Up. I pointed up? No, just keep pointing it. Okay, perfect. So as you heard from my colleague Rosie, we believe that there is a time bomb exploding every single minute in our ocean. Every minute, a garbage truck full of waste material is dumped into our ocean. Quite a lot of that is plastic. In fact, 300 million tons of plastic are produced every year globally. Only about 10% of that is recycled. That's a challenge. It's a huge challenge. We have governments all over the world that have very little waste management infrastructure. We have a continued, seemingly unabated increase in plastic polymer production. That was a tongue twister. That was good, wasn't it? So this problem isn't going to go away. This problem is only going to get worse. And we're only beginning to understand the impact associated with this increase in marine litter. So we know today that about 40% of what gets into the ocean is from packaging. Most of you in this room know that only about 5% of what's in the ocean can we actually see on the surface. Once plastic gets into the ocean, it's almost impossible to remove because it breaks down into microplastics. So stuff that you all in here know. But we also know that sea life is suffering. When sea life ingests plastic, it has a 50% mortality rate. It's projected by the year 2050 that 99% of all seabirds will have ingested plastic. These are real stats that are happening today. We also know that, the gratuitous turtle picture in there, the thing that actually started the movement and really got us to start paying attention to the dramatic impact, negative impact that plastic is having on marine life. The lovely Chris Jordan, who is also from Seattle, took these incredible images of these beautiful seabirds that are ingesting plastic and their babies are ingesting plastic. Nearly 80% of marine litter is plastic. And these are, if you look up here, there's a lot of like our everyday household items. If you look at those TikTok posters over there, you'll see a lot of what we collected from the beach cleanups. These are everyday household items. So there's something in our behavior, maybe there's something in our lack of understanding, awareness, maybe it's that we just don't really care, right? We don't have empathy. Maybe we've lost our way and we've lost a little bit of our humanity that is causing us to basically throw our household items away on the beach next to rivers and for it to end up into the ocean. But we truly believe that we're to blame, not as individuals, not as countries. And I want to pause here for just a second because there's a lot of information out there about the top five countries in the world or areas of the world that's contributing the most to this increase in waste products into our oceans. You can probably all name them. You probably all know who they are. But at the end of the day, we have corporations that continue to increase the production of packaging and not care for the end of life of these products. And then we also have us. For some reason, we can't figure out where to actually put the cup that can be recycled. Can we actually get it into the recycling bin? It's one of the most challenging things that we have to overcome. So we think that there is a whole systemic approach that needs to be taken. NGOs need to be working more closely with each other. We need to be working more with corporations. We need to be working more with governments to really make sure that we're focusing on some of the root causes of this waste issue. And then there's also the human element to it, because there is a responsibility that we have to solve for this issue. I mean, look at this waste on the beach. Right, the top 10 items most commonly found in international coastal cleanups, you're seeing quite a few of them here. This is actually from a beach in Bali. This happens every single morning. This waste product just continues to come up on the beach, and then every night it continues to go off, or twice a day as the tides change. And it's about 2 feet deep. Bottle caps, cups. So, with all of these really big, heavy issues around single-use plastics and around marine litter, the question that we asked ourselves is, where do we start? If we're going to do a campaign to really spark interest and inspire individuals to take action, where do we start? And we looked across a lot of different single-use plastic items, but importantly, we also took a look at how can we campaign in a way that's really going to get people excited. So we decided to sucker punch people. You think I'm kidding? We went to South by Southwest and we took a sucker punch photo booth and we did a stunt. We wanted to see what would happen if we sucker punched people with an octopus tentacle, because not a real one, but what does an octopus have to do with single-use plastics and marine litter, right? And why are we sucker punching people at South by Southwest? So we went to Mashable House, and we went to Rachel Ray's Feedback Lounge. This was a year ago, and here's what happened. Awesome. What was great about that stunt is that there was a 2-hour waiting line outside of Mashable House to get in to get sucker punched by this octopus tentacle, because everybody loves user-generated content, right? What gets things to spread virally? If you can have a little bit of fun with the issue, you can surprise and delight people just like a corporate brand would. Why do I want that car so bad? Why do I want that shoe? Why do I want to take that vacation? Why do I want to be associated with a specific beverage product? It's because marketers know how to sell this stuff. And so a lot of what we try to think about at the very beginning is, how do we talk and act and think and work like a brand would? Well, we surprise them. What does an octopus have to do with straws? Not a lot. I mean, more these days, if you saw the viral video where the octopus is grabbing for the straws on the bottom of the seafloor, which is really sad. But not a whole lot, right? So user-generated content. We also, who were some of the stars that you saw in there? Adrian was in there. I'm like, yeah, Adrian. Who else? This is on video. I love you, Adrian. It's great. Who else is on there? Neil deGrasse Tyson was on there. Yeah, Neil deGrasse Tyson was in there. So Neil deGrasse Tyson, putting him in that video got us sci-fi geeks. New audience for us, right? We don't normally talk to sci-fi geeks about ocean health issues. Who else was in there? There was a band in there from the 80s and the 90s. De La Soul. De La Soul was in there, so De La Soul got us hip-hop. And then there is a Sports Illustrated swimsuit model in there, Brooklyn Decker. So Brooklyn Decker was really interesting when she did a Facebook Live of getting punched by this octopus tentacle. That content hung on her Facebook page longer than any other content that she had put out there. So what it told us is that this is resonating. The content has stickiness, it's traveling, people are talking about it. This thing went viral in the course of 2 weeks and was written up by the Ad Council as a best practice in social impact campaign. So we thought, okay, well, we're onto something. Let's keep going, let's see what we can do next. So I wanna come back to the item that we selected, single-use plastic straws. Single-use plastic straws are not the most dangerous of products that are out there that get into the marine environment and cause harm to marine animals. Yes, it got sucked into a turtle's nose. Yes, it gets into the belly of seabirds. If we're really going to be focused on things that make an impact with marine life, we're gonna focus on plastic bags, we're gonna focus on utensils, and you know what? No more balloons at birthday parties. Okay, so single-use plastic straws. We took a little bit of a flack as an organization for why single-use plastic straws. It's pretty simple. It's the one thing that is out there for which there is a readily made, available, and easily implementable solution to change. What is it? To say no, right? That's all it is. You don't need to remember to bring your reusable straw with you, right? A restaurant doesn't actually have to have one for you. You can put your lips to the edge of a glass. You're probably not gonna die. I mean, heck, we're all here, right? A lot of us grew up in the 70s and 80s, and we're still living. So we felt like, you know what, maybe there's a little bit of a movement here that we can start to create. Maybe we can create this connection to this thing through a single-use plastic straw, and we can start to change the conversation, and it becomes a gateway plastic for us. It's not the end game, it's the beginning. So let me share with you what we did next, if it comes up. Okay, well, the other thing, 100 million Okay, back up for a second. So through that Sucker Punch video, just for some stats on impact, because we are very impact driven, everything we do has to have measurability. So over the course of the 2 weeks that video got shared over social, and we used a proxy, if you like it, if you share it, it means you're probably gonna be better than you were yesterday, which means you're probably gonna try to refuse some straws. So we estimated that about 100 million, slightly more, single-use plastic straws were to be refused over a calendar year as a result of that sucker punch, that stunt that we did, which was great, right? But we also know it's really difficult for people
to make a change. So we I suck.
I may not look like I suck, but I do.
Van Jones sucks.
I've been sucking on TV since I was 10.
Everybody could suck, I would suck.
I've sucked in over 90 countries.
Democrats, Republicans, independents. We all suck.
You know who else sucks? Kendrick Sampson.
I'm Kendrick Sampson, and I suck.
We suck together.
Sure, I've sucked, but Yuna sucks even more.
Yuna sucks.
And I suck.
And I suck.
And I suck. When someone tweets, I suck, I'm like, I know.
Statistically speaking, most of us suck. Most of us suck every day.
Suck, suck, suck.
Suck. Today, you probably used one of these.
500 million plastic straws are used in this country
every single day.
And many end up in the ocean, polluting water and killing sea life.
If we don't act now, by 2050, there will be more plastic in the ocean than fish.
You know, like you go snorkeling, you look down, and you don't see fish, you see plastic.
But there's something you can do about it.
I will stop sucking.
I will stop sucking.
We will all stop sucking.
We will all stop sucking.
If you do.
Hashtag stop sucking.
Thank you. So two things I want to point out about that PSA. One, that was a professionally produced PSA at Milk Studios in Los Angeles. We do a really good job of beg, borrowing, and stealing and getting costs of things down really, really, really low. All that talent was donated. You probably recognize some of those actors, right? Few of them, maybe. Did you notice the diversity that we selected? Ages, genders, look, cultural background, purposeful. What we didn't want is a bunch of white guys on there, right? The agency that we worked with, not that there's anything wrong with white guys, sorry, love white guys. Love you all. But the agency that we worked with to start identifying the talent that we're gonna put into the video, it literally was like all of the white restaurateurs in America that you could possibly have. And we thought, that's not gonna work, because what we need is we need this to be relatable. We need you to be able to look at that PSA and see yourself in one of those people, right? And to be able to relate to it a little bit. We also pulled in some very interesting, unique characters. So there's a guy named Jeb in there, and he's standing in the door, and he's got his squirrel suit hanging over his body. This guy literally flings himself out of helicopters over the Great Wall of China wearing nothing but a squirrel suit and a GoPro camera on his head, trying to hit a target while flying through the air at breakneck speeds. He's extremely popular in China. So there's a reason why he's on this video. It's because we needed for him to share this content with his audience so that it got picked up in China. Yuna, every time Yuna posts something about not sucking, she gets over 100,000 hits immediately. She's extremely popular within the Muslim community that she's from. And so for us, it was very purposeful to identify specific individuals that we knew were going to share content from this, and that would be able to help this conversation spread into communities that we normally can't tap into as a small NGO of three people. The other thing that this video did, if you saw at the very end, what we're asking people to do is just share it, just like it. There was a challenge code that we gave you if you wanted to go ahead and be a little bit more prescriptive in what you did, and you could sign up for this challenge code. You could share the challenge code to your community, and by sharing this challenge code to your community, we can now track you. Not like Cambridge Analytica can track you, but we can track you. And we can identify specifically who accepts your challenge. How far does it spread across your network? And what we found with Yuna is it went to 26 degrees of separation from her. Just sit with that for a second, right? Because we're always really interested in, did we make a difference with these videos? Did we increase awareness? Did we change attitudes? Did we cause behavior change? And we wanted to be able to measure it. So we can measure that Yuna's Stop Sucking social media challenge went to 26 degrees of separation from her. That's far. That's a lot. That's a lot of people. On average, it went to 12 degrees of separation, which is really incredible. So it told us that this content is traveling. It's still resonating. There's something about this. And I don't know if it's because at some point in our lives, we've all wanted to tell somebody to stop sucking. Maybe it's because it's clever. You know, stop sucking. Oh yeah, it's about straws. It's really kind of clever. I can share this content. Whatever it was working. But we knew that with social media challenges, that only go so far, right? So I can tell you all day long as a research psychologist that I'm okay with proxies. I'm okay with saying if somebody likes it or shares it, chances are they're probably, you know, doing better behavior. But what I really wanted to be able to do with this campaign is to tell you the very specific number of straws that we remove permanently from our waste stream. And we'd had a lot of success in working with venues. We had one venue go plastic straw free to the tune of 1.5 million straws a year. That's a lot of straws that they just got rid of. And then we had venues all over the world asking us for assistance and asking all the other straw programs that are out there. There were more than 20 at the time that we did this campaign in the United States. And so we were working collectively across all of those to see how do we start measuring and sharing our collective impact. But all of this felt really diffuse. So I can tell you there's a restaurant in New York, there's San Diego Airport, there's the sports team, there's a hotel, and it just doesn't feel really impactful, right? Like it just feels as like it's like onesie and twosie all over the place. So we decided to see, could we take over an entire city in a month and get them to go plastic straw free? Like just really concentrate our effort and see what kind of impact that we can have. So being from Seattle, originally from Alaska, I'm a hometown hero, and I had my eyes set on something I'll tell you about in just a second, but I wanted to see, could we get Seattle to go plastic straw free? We have a very strong commitment in Seattle to sustainable seafood. We have really progressive sports teams, really progressive port commissioners, really progressive restaurateurs. And I felt like, God, if we can't do it there, we can't do it anywhere. So let's see what we can do. So we ginned up a campaign we call Strawless in Seattle, because that's what it should be called. We tried really hard to get Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan involved. Didn't work. Failed miserably there, but we tried. And we wanted to see what kind of citywide impact could we have with a campaign that has a strong beginning, middle, and end, and was a little fun. So let me tell you about Strawless in Seattle. Surprisingly to us, we got the first airport in the country to go single-use plastic straw-free. SeaTac Airport. We got the first NFL stadium. We got the first iconic landmark, the Space Needle, which was the hardest one to come on board. It took the longest. We got the first Major League Baseball field. And we got over 100 restaurants to get engaged in this campaign. Pretty awesome, right? Now, the zoo and the... Thank you. The zoo and the aquarium were already single-use plastic straw-free, but they still participated, and they were really great in what they did. But we also knew... Don't start it yet. We also knew that to really have impact, to raise awareness among the hearts and minds of individuals, and quite honestly, to get more social media and media attention to really put a big spotlight on what the city was doing, we needed to take all of this great social media learnings that we had had with the sucker punch stunt and with our PSA for Stop Sucking and hyper-localize it. And I can't express enough the importance of really focusing on a local level and really harnessing the power and really the support of local influencers. So it doesn't have to be star power. It doesn't have to be A-list or B-list actors or musicians. You can actually make some very significant gains when you focus in with local influencers. So let's roll this localized PSA, and I want to see if you can guess who some of these folks are in this video. So with this campaign, we introduced this concept that somebody's stealing the straws in Seattle. We had that play in the Jumbotron at Major League Baseball game at the Mariners. We had it play in the Jumbotron for our Seattle Seahawks football team as well. It played on a looping reel. It's still actually playing on a looping reel. Nobody's told the airport that it's done, that we're done. We figured out who the straw thief was. But it's playing at SeaTac Airport still on a looping reel, so if you're there at 10, 11 at night or at 11 in the morning, you're gonna see this video playing. We had over 15,000 votes. So we had five celebrity athletes put up in one coach, put up as here are who the straw thieves might be. And so we had all these votes. And we had a closing celebration. And we had a bunch of hype around, well, who's going to show up and who's going to be the straw thief? Actually, our straw thief almost didn't show up, so it was going to be really embarrassing. But he did, and I'll tell you in a second who it is. What this campaign in Seattle did for us and for the movement, right? So now as we think about how do you take a straw campaign and how do you amplify the movement and how do you give it some lift, we had 334 million impressions just from this activation in Seattle. That's a lot. It's over 270 original articles on this across all genres. We were in People Magazine, we were on Fox News. We felt like that was the huge win. Fox News just covered this, that's amazing. We're getting somewhere here. But it gives us a lot of support, right? And really starts to change the conversation. In Seattle, just during the month of September, we removed 2.3 million single-use plastic straws. Over the course of the next 10 months, we projected 23 million straws removed. Importantly, the city of Seattle saw such market-based support concentrated in just a couple of weeks that within the first week of the campaign, they announced a permanent transition away from single-use plastic straws and utensils starting in July 2018. That we felt like was a huge win, right? So now we're estimating anywhere upwards of 60 million straws permanently removed over the course of a year as a result of this one tiny concentrated effort in Seattle. The other thing that's really important about this is that given that the plastic straw for us is a gateway plastic, what we were really interested to see is when you start the conversation about straws, what happens? Are people curious? Do they start asking questions? Are they content with the straw? So two observations. One, there's this latent hatred of single-use plastic straws that just kept coming out. When we tried to recruit Van Jones was very easy to recruit for the PSA. He sent us photos, selfies, of him with his reusable straws. Like, finally somebody's asking me, I hate the straw. This is my reusable straw. And the second is that the straw actually made people really curious. So we started getting questions from restaurateurs about, well, wait a minute, why do we get oysters and clams in plastic bags that we can't recycle? Good question. Why do you? Can you change that? And then we also started getting a question from Major League Baseball of, well, what else can we do? And so we started looking at what are some of the other low-hanging plastics, and lo and behold, that bobblehead doll up there, that Mariner's Moose, comes encased in single-use plastic that can't be recycled, packed in with styrofoam. Seems like a pretty good area to start to take a look at. Very easy low-hanging fruit to start getting rid of more single-use plastics. So we felt like it was starting to change the conversation.
Adrian Grenier, my entire Sea Legacy team and I accept your challenge to stop sucking. Thank you. Over 500 million plastic straws are used every day in the United States alone. Just imagine how many are used every year around the world. We're talking hundreds of billions of straws. So with that said, I challenge you, Starbucks, to stop sucking and to find an alternative to single-use plastic straws.
The other learning for us, a campaign like Stop Sucking, and when you hyper-localize it in a city like Seattle, you start seeing these hometown heroes with insane followings. Paul Nicklin, every single beautiful Nat Geo photograph that he puts up on wildlife gets hundreds of thousands of hits. Right, and so for us, it was a very easy ask to Paul to get engaged in the campaign, and immediately he's like, yep, is it okay if I tell Starbucks they suck, please? And McDonald's, and we're like, sure, let's see what happens there. And then also, Russell Wilson. So one of the funniest posts as part of this campaign is he did a, hi, I'm Russell Wilson and I suck, and it came the Wednesday after a game in which he actually really did suck. It was a really bad football game. And so the comments were like, you do suck, dude, and you better get better. And then all of a sudden, you saw people shift. Like, when you read the comments, you see them shift. Wait a minute, straws? Russell Wilson straws? What is this straw thing? 500 million used every year? What on earth is going on? And so you just saw an unlikely voice in this space starting to change the hearts and minds of football fans. Right? So you never know exactly what's going to happen within a particular campaign, but we know that we have a formula for success for these citywide takeovers, and we're in the process of releasing a toolkit coming up in the next couple of weeks to help anybody who wants to do a citywide takeover see how to do it. So I'm happy to share that with everybody here. But it does require strong leadership. It requires being a little bit funny and fun and allowing yourself to have a little bit of levity. And when you do that, you can get people to really participate and you make it inclusive in your campaign. I want to go back to this picture, though. This one, for me, is really where the entire conversation about the straw campaign started. So we're in Bali, Indonesia. We're launching the Clean Seas campaign in partnership with the UN Environment. We're getting ready to announce this really important engagement that we have with Dell Corporation around intercepting ocean-bound plastic so that basically we can turn the faucet off while others are working on infrastructure and recyclability of products. And then we go snorkeling with mantas. And this is on the beach on the coast of Sanur. And everywhere we look, there is a Starbucks straw on the beach. Everywhere we go. You put your hand down in the sand and you pull it up and you get 10 at one time. And so we thought, this is egregious, right? And so if we start a conversation with Starbucks around what we're doing from a campaign standpoint and what we're seeing, like you can see that straw from space, almost, not really, but kind of. Makes a nice story. I would love it if we could, actually. But it's a trademark color, and so we thought from a brand standpoint, surely this global giant, I was a former Starbucks barista, I'm from Seattle, can't we make change happen here with this big giant? Let's see what we can do. So at the same time, we started a conversation with Starbucks. Starbucks at the time had put a bunch of money into their marketing campaigns, featuring this green straw as its number one brand asset. Raise your green straws. But we started a very friendly dialogue with them to say, here's a great opportunity. We have an alternative straw, we have a campaign, we're gonna do a big campaign in Seattle in September, you could become the hometown hero. Laid out the red carpet, the green carpet, I guess it is, laid out the green carpet for them and gave them so many opportunities to really participate in this. We showed them that Gen Z and millennials care pretty deeply about this issue. In fact, millennial moms care more deeply about ocean health and in particular plastic pollution than most other environmental issues. They have a millennial and a Gen Z issue at Starbucks. Millennials will buy their coffee, but they will turn the label around so they aren't embarrassed to be seen with it. They know they have a millennial issue. So again, we said, well, certainly if you address your straw issue, maybe more millennials will buy your coffee and love you forever and ever and ever. And we also knew that in Santa Cruz, thanks to the incredible work of organizations like The Last Plastic Straw, PPC, Surfrider, and others, that Starbucks had to actually start to change out its supply of plastic straws and test out a new straw. So that paper straw is the aardvark paper straw. It is branded green color. It's very expensive because of how much ink is actually put into creating that green color. But it worked well. And while maybe there were some concerns from customers about change, change is hard for all of us, for the most part, it was fairly well received. The other thing that happened during the same time period is Starbucks continued to expand its footprint. Today, Starbucks adds one new store every 15 hours in a part of the world in Southeast Asia that has no waste management infrastructure to really support the increase in waste that's going to be coming out of Starbucks. One new store every 15 hours, knowingly having the waste problem that they do. So we felt like all of these are really compelling reasons to start to address this issue. Sadly for us, it wasn't enough. And Starbucks made a decision to not move forward on changing out what we felt like was the easiest thing that could happen, which was that single-use plastic straw. Instead, what happened is a coalition of over 20 NGOs started to point themselves directly at the company and start to ask for change, force change, demand change to happen. There's a petition right now that has hit well over 1 million signatures. And then last week at the Starbucks shareholders meeting, they were outside protesting, and we had Adrian Grenier inside delivering a proposal, a shareholders resolution from As You Sow to the shareholders, to which the shareholders voted no. The company recommended the shareholders voted no, but I'm happy to report that 29% of the shareholders voted yes for it. We see that as a silver lining. So we'll see more and more focus on Starbucks because they didn't address something that we felt like was really easy to address, and more concerns from the NGO community about the announcements that were made and the environmental and fiduciary responsibility that a company like Starbucks has to really address its waste issues at scale. There's a lot more to come with this story. One thing that I will just end on, because I am right at time, but one thing I will end on here is a piece of good news. So I don't know if anyone saw, but yesterday there was a story that came out from the UK that McDonald's in the UK is stopping utilization of a single-use plastic straw in favor of a paper straw or no straw. They have an on-demand policy now, so they are forcing customers to ask for this. So McDonald's is doing what other fast-moving consumer good companies have said can't be done, because they have the strength of leadership and because they have the care for the planet in mind. Regardless of what you think about McDonald's, that was a massive move on their part and something that we should all support and really applaud and make sure that our voice is really heard so that perhaps others, like Starbucks, can also take that same action. So thank you for listening to my story. I hope for those who have friends and family that still suck, then you'll be able to find some tidbits in here to share with them to help us all suck a little bit less. Thank you.